Welcome to church this morning. We want to welcome you. Thank you for new faces. Hope you don't feel too bad that we have an empty sanctuary, but we still very welcome and don't be surprised if everyone here will talk to you after the service. So this is very exciting. Just a new day. It's a beautiful day today, and we just want to thank you for joining us this morning. Let us open up a time of prayer, and we'll get into worship. Thank you, Father. We thank you so much for this new day, glorious day. We thank you, Father, for who you are, and just for the blessings that you give to us. We ask, Father, that this morning, that you prepare our hearts, as you have already prepared our hearts, Lord, when we've risen from our slumber. But we really ask, Father, just for open ears to understand your word, to learn your word, Father, but also to put into action the things that we are learning today. I thank you, Father, for this time of fellowship, of just being able to come together and come into worship. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together and worship.
Lord, all the earth is all worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart. Every breath we could ever breathe, we live.
Again, welcome to our service today. I've been doing this for about 8 months now, and I'm still having troubles. Welcome again. All right. Just some quick announcements. So today is the 19th. Next week, by the way, thank you for wearing the masks. I know it's a bit of a bummer, that thing. I wonder where you were on Wednesday when everyone's cell phones sort of went off at the same time. I was just at home, not doing much, but I know I have friends who were at a restaurant, and it's like the whole restaurant just lit up with that alarm. Thank you for wearing your masks again in our service. It's a bit of a bummer, and hopefully we'll just kind of get through this this time. Next week, next Sunday, will be our last service in this building, only in this building. From October, we will be moving to the St. Giles Presbyterian building, which is just like four blocks north on 10th Street, right before you get to Confederation Park. On October, when we do start meeting in St. Giles, that service starts at 10 a.m. All right, so next Sunday, we will be here at our normal time, 11 a.m. The following Sunday after that, we will be at St. Giles at 10 a.m. About the, some people are wondering about this announcement. It was only made just a few days ago. And it's just a small oversight. This partnership with St. Giles has been in the works for several months. I was given a small hint of it, I think back in July, but at that time they didn't say that we were moving to that church. And so it's just a small oversight, but we are working with this situation, the information that was given, and we're just doing the best that we can. We were supposed to move today, but I told them that's a little too quick, and we need more time just to prepare everyone for this move. And so I am looking forward to the move. The building is it is bigger than our space here. There's a lot more facilities and more things that we can do there. And then it's right next to the park, and so that'll be a good thing. All right. I took this picture about 9:30, so about an hour and a half, hour and 45 minutes ago. And I did the 10K run at the Scotia 10K run today. Normally, I would have taken the day off, right, just to rest after a run like that. But because of the situation and because we only have like 2 weeks left in this building, I felt it important that I just continue to be here and to be with you all. I knew last Monday that I wasn't ready for 10K. I've been having knee problems for the last 2 weeks, and it's just it's been really bad. My peak running was 20 minutes, and then after that, my knees just wouldn't let me go further. And I have a guy that works at the YMCA, and I spoke to him about it on Wednesday, and he knew what it was. I don't remember the name of it. It is fixable with some exercises. It is fixable, but he said on Wednesday, stop running. Okay, so here I am. I'm not even ready for 10K, and on Wednesday he says, stop running. Don't run. Okay, just do your marathon. Just don't run again until that marathon, and then come see me afterwards. And so I was a bit worried because I didn't know what time I would show up today. And but really, by God's miracle, it's just amazing. I didn't walk. The entire 10K, I did not walk. I didn't have any problems with my knee. And I finished it in an hour and 17 minutes, which I think was even better than my time 2 years ago. And so that's just really by God's strength that I was able to do that. Coming from the Stampede grounds, my wife dropped me off here, and then she went home, and I couldn't even walk up the stairs. It was really hard. I was just sore everywhere. But I'm okay now. I was able to sit for about 30 minutes, and I'm very happy to be here with all of you, so this is really special for me. Let's open up a time of prayer, and we'll just get into our message today. Father God, we thank you again for this day. We thank you, Lord, just for your love and your presence. And I thank you, Father, that strength comes from you alone. You helped me, Lord, to run the race, to finish the race, to finish it quite well, in fact, but this could only come from you. I just, right up to even this morning, I just had a really hard time going upstairs, but for whatever reason, Lord, I was able to finish the race. I just thank you so much for that that strength. I thank you, Lord. I know, Father, that you are with us always, and I do thank you, Father, for your presence. And I pray, Lord God, help us to understand your word today, because we have some important things that we need to learn about your expectations of us and how we ought to live in this world. And so I just really ask for, again, your presence, your blessing in this time. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We started 2 weeks ago, oh no, more than two weeks ago, beginning of September, we started a series on parables. And 2 weeks ago, I spoke on the parable of the sower. And we learned in the parable of the sower that seed fell on different types of soils. And each one of those soils are the different types of hearts that could hear God's word. And so today we are going to continue in this sort of a theme, I guess, of the parable of the sower, because 2 weeks ago I spoke on the book of Mark, but today we're going to be looking at Matthew 13, and the very first parable on Matthew 13 is actually the parable of the sower. And I won't be repeating my sermon when we get to Matthew 13, but there's a total of seven parables in this one chapter alone. And let me just, I'm getting ahead of myself here, so let me just kind of back myself up a little bit here. Okay, so one of the things that I like to do is I want to introduce the book to you, so the book of Matthew. And for my own personal studies, my favorite question to ask the Bible or to ask God's word is why, right? Why does Matthew write what he does? Why does Jesus do what he does? Why did this happen? Why this and why that? And Matthew is very interesting because just by with its structure and the purpose that Matthew was written, okay? So if you can sort of imagine, I don't know if you know the story of the road to Emmaus, right? So this is after Jesus died. There's two guys that are walking to this town, and then a third guy shows up. It's Jesus, but to them, they don't recognize that it's Jesus. The third guy shows up, and Jesus asks him the question, so, you know, like, what's going on? And these two guys say to Jesus, have you not heard? Like, did you, you know, where were you the last few days? You know, this there's this guy named Jesus, and we thought he was the Messiah, but he died. He was killed. He was crucified. And now we just don't know what to think. And then what Jesus did was he opened up the Old Testament scriptures, okay? So he opened up the Old Testament scriptures, and he explained to them everything that took place and that had to take place and that Jesus truly is the Messiah. And then, of course, we know the end of the story. They invite Jesus in for a meal, and then when Jesus breaks the bread, he disappears, and they realize, oh, that's Jesus. And they were saying how our hearts were burning when he was explaining the Old Testament passages to us. Okay, so these are two guys who were confused. They thought Jesus was the Messiah, and then he died, okay? But basically, the entire Jewish population, those who did believe in Jesus, they thought he was the Messiah, but then he died, okay? So the rest of the Jews were also confused, and they're like, okay, so we thought he was the Messiah, but because he died, he was not the Messiah. Then we're still waiting for someone. But then Matthew comes along and he writes this book, and he's explaining to the people how Jesus truly is the Messiah. So this is the purpose of Matthew, is he's proving to the Jews. So Matthew is writing to the Jews specifically, not to Gentiles. Matthew is not the only gospel. John's written to Jews as well. Luke is written to Gentiles. Mark is written to whoever. But Matthew is written specifically to Jews. Okay, and he's proving to the Jews that Jesus truly is the Messiah. Matthew, of all of the books in the New Testament, Matthew quotes the Old Testament the most. Why? Because these are the passages that the Jews know. The Jews, they know all of these things, okay? But Matthew quotes it the most because he's showing people, he's tracking through the Old Testament to show people that Jesus, this is Jesus that they're talking about in the Old Testament, and these are all of the things that took place. And so there is that. All right. In our world today, especially for those who are entering in university as their first year, when we're in high school or growing up in our homes, we're usually sheltered from outside philosophies, other ideas. But then when you enter university, you start meeting a lot more people, a lot more variety of people, especially if you grew up in the church. Then suddenly you're just in the middle of this campus, university or Mount Royal or even State. You're just in the middle of all of these students here, and everyone has ideas of who God is. There's really almost no atheists in our society, in our world. There are atheists, but really there's very, very few of them. Everyone believes in a God, some God or another, and not everyone, but a large percentage of people follow a certain religion. And so really the main, I think, ideology promoted in the university, and because I know, but I'm not familiar with Mount Royal or State, is the idea of coexist. And we see it on bumper stickers in cars, and we see it maybe every now and then. And basically that just means that multiple religions, and they all point to the same God. And so we want to be in peace with one another. We don't want to have any conflict or fighting amongst different religions because we're, you know, just different expressions of faith, but we're pointing to the same God. And this is really the ideology that we're getting, especially in university, and would just continue on in life. This image on the right contradicts. I've never seen this image before. It is very unique when I did see it in a Google search. The Bible verse there, John 14:6, it basically says that coexist is not true at all. Okay, so it's a very bold and a strong statement. It says Jesus, oh, I don't know what version that is. Jesus said to them, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So either Jesus was lying or he was telling the absolute truth. And if Jesus was telling the absolute truth, that means this idea of coexist or universalism is completely false. Completely false. But then the rest of the world is telling us that coexist is true. That's part of the problem. And that's part of the challenge for us as Christians when we see these things. Now, Satan doesn't care which religion you follow, as long as you're not following Jesus. He doesn't care, okay? He does make our lives more difficult. He makes Christian lives more difficult, but he really doesn't care which religion you follow as long as it's not Jesus. That's the only thing he doesn't want you to do. Don't follow. You do whatever you want. You sacrifice, you know, you cut your skin, or you do anything. Just don't follow Jesus. And if you are following Jesus, Satan wants you to mess you up. He wants to skew your idea of what it means to follow Jesus. I'll get more into that as we get into our sermon. But we get a lot of some Christians even saying church is a waste of time. Or maybe just people in general. Church is a waste of time. Those are some of the statements. Social media, you'll see a lot of these things. Some would say, "I am a Christian, but I'm against organized religion." You know, I've heard this a few times. Now, what happens if you make a genuine faith confession in Jesus, but then you join a church or community whose faith practice does not align with the Bible? And this could happen quite often. And what happens if that happens to you? And or sometimes even in our own churches, some people pick and choose what they want to do and what they don't want to do, right? There's certain things that people don't want to do. Maybe they don't want to pray for a couple hours. Okay, I'm not asking anyone to pray for a couple hours. I don't even do that myself. But, maybe people enjoy the worship and sometimes a sermon, but they don't want to give, right? And so we have a pick and choose of the things that we want to do and the things that we don't want to do. And is this okay or not? Matthew 13 will tell us if this is really okay or not. And it's quite interesting. Okay, so in Matthew is not chronological, okay? Even though we have the birth narrative at the beginning of the book and we have the death and resurrection at the end of the book and the commissioning at the end of the book, Matthew is not chronological. And so we enter into this middle part of the book of Matthew. Matthew organizes his book topically. He has a specific message he wants to give, and he's got a specific order that he's giving this message. And so everything in the middle from chapter 4 all the way to chapter 25, they're organized topically, okay? This is not in order. And so we can see, the first part of 5, that Jesus is announcing God's kingdom. He's announcing God's kingdom. The Sermon on the Mount is in here. He's talking about what his disciples look like. By the way, this Sermon on the Mount, it's in Matthew chapter 5, if you're familiar with it. There is a, this is not really part of my message, but I still want to mention it anyways. There is a body language that we don't get. There is a body language that Jesus does. That is, it's very much cultural, okay? So when the Bible says, or when the people, when the Pharisees, religious teachers, Sadducees, or whatever, if they go into a posture of going up on a hill, or if they're inside a synagogue or a temple, and they go and sit down, that means they are about to teach, okay? And so in the Sermon on the Mount, we find that Jesus goes up on the hill and he sits down. And then all of the disciples go and sit down around him. But then there's also a large crowd because Jesus is doing this outside. Now we know that when Jesus teaches his disciples, right, sometimes he's teaching his disciples when they're out and about, and sometimes he's teaching his disciples when they're just in a little room, okay? But here in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus goes up on the hill and he sits down. The disciples know he's about to do some teaching, and so they go and sit down around him. But Jesus is doing this outside. And so there's a whole crowd that sort of gathers around, ready to listen to what Jesus has to say. This message on the Sermon on the Mount, it's actually in Matthew chapters 5 through 7. This message on the Sermon on the Mount was not for the crowd. The message was for the disciples. Okay? Jesus did it in the presence of the crowd, but the message, the sermon, the lesson was for the disciples. Why does Jesus do this out in public? If this message and lesson was for the disciples, he could have done it in a room, in a small room. And why does he do it in the public? It's because Jesus is telling the world what his disciples look like. Isn't that interesting? Jesus is revealing to society, to the world, what Jesus' disciples look like. So everything in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5 through 7, these are everything that Jesus is expecting of us. And the world knows it, actually. Well, they don't know it by detail, but they know a lot of things. Because if people outside, they know that you're a Christian, but then you do something questionable, they might actually say to you, "You call yourself a Christian?" It can be embarrassing sometimes, but it happens, right? It happens. And we can't always escape that. There is a purpose in that. I'll come back to that a little bit later, okay? The second section, Jesus brings the kingdom into people's lives. The third section, people's response, kingdom of heaven illustrated. This is the section that we will be focusing on today. Okay, so our passage is Matthew 13, but I'm actually going to be talking about chapters 11 and 12. The fourth section, upside down kingdom, what does that mean? To be the greatest, you must be the least. You want to be great in the kingdom of heaven? You must serve. You must be a servant. Actually, it doesn't say that you must serve. It says you must be a servant. It's a little bit deeper in meaning. Okay, upside down kingdom. And then we've got the clash of the kingdoms, right? And we've got the Pharisees' idea of what the kingdom ought to be, and then we've got Jesus' idea of what the kingdom ought to be. And so the Pharisees want to get rid of Jesus. Okay, but again, our focus is on the third section. Okay, we want to look at Matthew chapter 13, the parables in Matthew chapter 13. It is a response to all of the various, it's not a response. It is a summary of all of the responses to Jesus, okay? So at the middle of Matthew, we've got various responses to Jesus. Some of them are positive, some of them are neutral, and some of them are negative, okay? And then we get to Matthew chapter 13, all of these parables, and it is a summary of all of these different responses in Matthew chapters 12 and 13. It's really quite fun. Okay, and this is the kind of stuff that I really enjoy. Okay, so we have in Matthew, first 19 verses of chapter 11, we've got John the Baptist. Okay, John the Baptist is in prison, and then he sends his disciples out because he wants to know if Jesus is truly the Messiah. Now, we get John the Baptist early in the story where he baptizes Jesus, and he declares to the people that this is the one who is to come. This is the one whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. But then later on in Jesus' ministry, John is like, why is he sending his disciples? Is he confused? I think he is confused. But he's also in prison. Okay, so John might be hearing stories or rumors or whatever from his disciples and from others of what Jesus is doing. And we know that some of the things that Jesus did was not pleasant. People didn't like what Jesus had to say. They didn't like some of the things that he was expecting people to follow. A lot of the things, especially the Pharisees, they really enjoyed, they didn't follow, right? They didn't follow the Ten Commandments very well. They made excuses how to avoid honoring their parents, right? So there was a number of things that the Pharisees were doing that were really against God, but then Jesus is trying to re-educate people. No, it's not like that. It's not like that at all. It's like this. And people didn't like it. They didn't like what he was saying. And so John was probably hearing this in prison. He can't go out and verify for himself, for his own eyes, so he sent his disciples out and says, are you truly the Messiah? And Jesus says, well, go back and tell John this is what's happening. People are blind are seeing, the lame is walking. All of these miracles are taking place. Okay, so John's response may be neutral in the beginning, but I think positive. I think toward the end of his life it was positive. He would have known. The Holy Spirit would have confirmed to him that Jesus truly is the Messiah. The next one is the townspeople, okay? So the townspeople, their response is negative. Okay, they've seen many miracles, but they are not repenting, right? So their response is negative. The next section is not a response of a people, but it's just more like of a teaching in 11, 25 to 30. Okay, Jesus says, the message is hidden from those who think they are wise and revealed to the childlike. Okay, so why does Jesus speak in parables? Because he doesn't want everyone to understand the truth. I should rephrase that. He wants everyone to understand the truth, but for the people who can't be bothered to put the effort into understanding the truth, he doesn't want them to know the truth. Okay? And there is a reason for that. I shared that 2 weeks ago, and I said that it's because he doesn't want people to have a false sense of salvation. Right? What did I say 2 weeks ago? I mentioned missionaries who went to Brazil. People were rejecting the gospel, and then finally they said, okay, so just come to church once a year and you're good. You can go to heaven. Okay? Jesus doesn't want that. Jesus doesn't want people to think that salvation is a formula. You pray this prayer and then you're good. Okay? Jesus doesn't want that. And so this is why some of the truths are hidden from people. And they're not hidden to be permanently hidden. They're hidden so that it can be discovered, it can be found when you put an effort into looking for them. All right. Also in 11, that same passage, Jesus says that his yoke is easy to bear and not burdensome. Okay. So Jesus' disciples, people who do decide to commit their lives to Jesus and obeying him, well, it's not difficult. It's not hard. It's not overbearing. Okay. So Jesus wants to confirm that. The next section in chapter 12, verses 1 to 14, we've got the Pharisees again, okay? So the disciples are hungry, they're walking through a field, and they're picking heads of grain, and they're eating it. And this is on a Sabbath, and the Pharisees are accusing them of harvesting, right? They call it harvesting, you know, picking these grains. But anyways, it's still work. It's still work for them. And then later on, Jesus, there's a man with a shriveled hand in the temple, and the Pharisees are wondering, is he going to heal him on the Sabbath? And then Jesus says to him, well, is it righteous or is it good? Is it good to do righteous works on the Sabbath? I can't remember the exact wording. And then they don't respond. And then Jesus is a little bit upset with them because they're just being stubborn. And then he heals the guy's hand, right, on the Sabbath. And then the Pharisees are upset, and then they begin to plot his death. And so the next session, we find out that Jesus knows what the Pharisees are planning, and then he leaves them. Okay, we come back to Pharisees again in chapter 12, 22 to 40. So the Pharisees' negative response, right? The second set of Pharisees, probably not the same set of Pharisees as the first set, but we come back to Pharisees, and Jesus is casting demons out of people, and then the Pharisees are accusing Jesus of being a prince of demons, right? That's the only way you can cast out demons is only if you're the prince of demons. And Jesus is like, you know, demons would never fight against themselves. They would never win a battle. They would never win anything. But then Jesus goes on and says, blasphemy against the Holy Spirit is unforgivable. And blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, this is like speaking against the Holy Spirit, but it could also be like denying the truth of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit says that Jesus is the Messiah, but if you deny that truth, that is unforgivable. There's an analogy of the tree, the good tree bearing good fruit, and then the bad tree bearing bad fruit. This is in the Pharisee section. So obviously that's a negative response. Chapter 12, 41 to 45, we have the analogy of Jonah, where Jesus says, the Son of Man will be in the belly of the earth, just like Jonah was in the belly of fish. Son of Man will be in the belly of the earth for 3 days. We've got the analogy of the Queen of Sheba, and this one is very important for us. Because Jesus says that there's this queen who traveled from a distant land to learn about God. Okay, when we read this, I can't remember if it's 1 Kings or 2 Kings. I'm pretty sure it's 1 Kings. It's only like 12 verses long, this whole story of the Queen of Sheba visiting Solomon. Okay, but when we read that story, we don't fully realize the amount of work involved in what she just did. Right? Because we read at the end of that story that she gave more to Solomon than anyone else combined. Like, she just gave, like insane amount, okay? But we know that the Queen of Sheba, it's about, 1,000 kilometers south of where Solomon was. But how did she get there? Okay, she's not going to fly there. It's going to be by camel and possibly by boat, okay? This is a several-month journey to get there and then to get back. All for the purpose of learning about God. She went to great lengths. She spent a ton of money. She gave a lot to Solomon once she discovered the truth about God. Okay. And that's important for us as we get later on into our sermon here, our message. Okay, the last one, Jesus' mother and brothers. Okay, so this is sort of a neutral response. Someone in the crowd says, your mother and brothers are outside waiting for you. And then Jesus goes into and says, well, who are my mothers and brothers? Well, those who do the will of God are my mothers, are my brothers, my sisters, and my mother. Okay, those who do the will of God. This is very important. All right, now we're getting into our sermon. Tried to fly through that real quick. But I'll fly through this too as well, actually. Okay, so now we've got seven parables in Matthew chapter 13. We talked about the sower 2 weeks ago. Okay, so I won't go into that. We've got the wheat and the weeds, okay, the parable of the wheat and the weeds. The farmer planted good seed, but the enemy came at night and planted weeds. Okay? Both grow together. I think both are pew warmers. Okay? Both seeds are pew warmers. The weed won't necessarily stay in the pew, so the weed won't necessarily stay in the church, but they do want to proliferate. The weeds do want their message to proliferate. And especially if the weed is in the church and they are the pew warmers, they want their ways to be justified, so they're going to be pushing their ways or their ideology. I had one guy at a church I used to attend. Unfortunately, he didn't say it to me. I just heard it from some other co-leaders. But this guy was saying, it's not a sin to live with my girlfriend. And if I heard him say that, I would have told him, you're right, it's not a sin to live with your girlfriend because marriage has nothing to do with the ceremony. Marriage, spiritually speaking, is it's a consummation of the marriage. That's marriage. The church ceremony is a formality. So you want to live with your girlfriend, go ahead. But the way God sees it is you're married. And that's how God sees it, whether you do the ceremony or not. But then if you have multiple partners or, you know, like before you become a believer, the marriage takes place spiritually and is consummated by the relationship. But then when you sleep with another, you've divorced one and married in another. Okay, and this is all happening spiritually. Okay. But anyways, so we have these ideologies of people that just want to justify themselves, and the only way that they can feel good about themselves is if they get other people to think the same way. And it doesn't matter what it is. It could be anything. It could be anything, right? But they just want themselves to be justified, and they want other people to think the same way or to sort of believe in the same way, and then they could just feel good about themselves and continue to think that they're not sinning. Two of the most dangerous lies, in my opinion, are cheap gospel. Okay, so just like that example, only go to church once a year and you're good. It's a cheap gospel. There's another one, I think it's the same name as the book, but love wins. There's another ideology that says love wins, and it doesn't matter whether you share the gospel or not, everyone's going to heaven. And so you could not share the gospel ever, because everyone's going to go to heaven anyways. God is love, and so love wins. That's the cheap gospel. The second thing I think is a dangerous lie is, well, it's actually similar to love wins, universalism. Follow any religion you want. We go to the same heaven. When universalism first came out, it was a former Christian that actually put forth this ideology. And he says, it doesn't matter what religion you follow, we're all going to the same heaven. But there's another religion whose heaven is where the men can have as many women as they want. And then the women are saying, well, I don't want that kind of heaven. And so this guy who came up with his ideology says, okay, so, well, maybe women's heaven is different. Okay? So universalism doesn't work. It doesn't work. Everyone's idea of heaven is quite different. And, you know, and some people don't want that kind of a heaven. And so they have to modify this ideology or this philosophy to accommodate. Okay, they have to accommodate, and it changes. It keeps changing because once someone comes up with some sort of argument, then they'll say, okay, so maybe it'll be like this. And that's the whole philosophy of universalism. And this is something that people love. This is something that people embrace so that they don't have to follow one religion over the other. Or so they don't have to follow Christianity, okay? They were instructed not to pull out the weeds because you might pull out the good plants. Now, this is bad news for us because if we have weeds within our churches, it's going to be rough. It's going to be difficult. We might fall into just different philosophies, okay? But then it also tells us that the weeds, the good plants and the weeds will be separated at harvest. This means the end of the world. So at the end of the world, it will be separated, the bad seed or the weeds, from the good seeds. The next parable is the parable of the mustard seed. Okay, the mustard grows very quickly. Mustard grows very quickly, but it also says that this mustard will become a tree so that birds will come and rest. Okay, mustards don't become trees ever. A bush, yes. And the bushes can get quite large where birds can come and make a nest, but it never becomes a tree. Now, when I was introducing parables, I also mentioned to you that sometimes Jesus uses exaggeration to make a point. Okay, so in the parable of the sower, the seed that fell on good soil would produce a harvest 30, 60, 100 times more than what was sown. The people, farmers, typically on a good season would expect a harvest of 10 times more than what was sown. But then Jesus is saying, no. With God, it's 30, 1600. And so then when Jesus uses exaggeration, he is trying to surprise people to get their attention, but at the same time, he's actually speaking truth. Because obedience to God does produce a large harvest. It does produce more than you actually put in. You still have to put in. You still got to put some effort in it, but it does produce more. And so going down to the parable of the yeast. Okay, so biblically speaking, yeast is normally used in a negative sense. Right? This is why we have unleavened bread for certain festivals. Because yeast is normally used in a negative sense, but there, here, and I think it's the only time it's ever used in the positive sense. But when it says three measures, I know I'm not reading most of these. Maybe I should start reading this one because this is a short one. Jesus also used this, this is in verse 33, so chapter 13, verse 33. Jesus also uses this illustration. The kingdom of heaven is like the yeast a woman used in making bread. Even though she only put a little yeast in three measures of flour, it permeated every part of the dough. Jesus always used stories and illustrations like these when speaking to the crowds. In fact, he never spoke them without using such parables. This fulfilled what God had spoken through the prophet, Old Testament. I will speak to you in parables. I will explain things hidden since the creation of the world. Okay? So, exaggeration here, we miss it because what is three measures? Right? Three measures is about 60 pounds of flour. Okay? So just a little bit of a yeast. It spreads into about 60 pounds of flour. Okay. The next parable of the hidden treasure, is only one verse, I think. Verse 44, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that a man discovered hidden in a field. In his excitement, he hid it again and sold everything he owned to get enough money to buy the field. Quite often when I read this before and when I've learned it in Bible study, I've always taken the treasure to mean the gospel or to mean Jesus himself. It's not. The treasure is you. The treasure is you. It's you and me. The treasure is the church. This is very interesting. And so who is this guy that discovers this treasure? This guy is Jesus. And this is Jesus. And buying the whole field, this is the world. This is the world. Okay. So at first thought, when we kind of read this over, gloss it over, actually, when we kind of gloss this over, we come to whatever conclusions. But then this is a good example. As you meditate on it, as you figure it out, what is Jesus saying? Why did he say it? Why is he using this illustration? This is actually confirmed in the next parable, which is the next verse. I'll go into that shortly. But basically, the treasure is the church. It's the people, Jesus' disciples. The field is the world. And then a man, which is Jesus, it says he sold everything, bought the field. Okay? And Jesus gave his life. He did sell everything. He gave up everything. He gave his life. And he bought the world. But it's not the world that he wants. It's the treasure that he wants. Love doesn't win. Well, God is love, but love doesn't win in that way. And Jesus is after the treasure, but he buys the whole world. The next parable, which is also one verse, and it does confirm, which is the parable of the pearl, okay? So, verse 45, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant on the lookout for choice pearls. When he discovered a pearl of great value, he sold everything he owned and bought it. Okay, so this is another sort of a cultural thing in Jewish society, is that people who studied the Torah were referred to as pearls. It's quite interesting. And I only learned this week. But people who study the Torah, okay, so the Torah is the first five books of the Bible, but the Torah for us is the whole Bible, okay? So people who study God's word is considered a pearl, a beautiful pearl, a great pearl, okay? And so this man is looking for choice pearls. There's a lot of pearls, but he's only looking for the choice pearls, right? In our pews, we've got good fruit and we got bad fruit. The man is coming in here and he's looking for choice pearls. And the pearls are those who spend the time to study God's word, okay? And so this is how we know in the other one that the treasure is the church, it's the people. The last parable of Matthew 13 is the parable of the fishing net. I will read a few verses. So this is from 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like fishing net that was thrown into the water and caught fish of every kind. When the net was full, they dragged it up onto the shore, sat down, and sorted the good fish in the crates, but threw the bad ones away. That is the way it will be at the end of the world. The angels will come and separate the wicked people from the righteous, throwing the wicked into a fiery furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Do you understand these things? Oh, actually, I'm going to talk about a couple of verses later. But the main point here is that at the end of the world, people are going to be separated. The ones producing good fruit from the ones producing bad fruit. Okay. We don't know. We don't necessarily know who they are. We can guess, right? When we look at people and when we're friends with people, we can guess who they are. But we don't really know. Only God knows. Only God knows who that is. And that will happen at the end of the world. That they will be separated. Okay? They're all in one net. The other important thing is they're all in one net. They're all in the world. And they might be all in the church. But at the end of the world, we're going to find out who's in and who's not. As I look at all seven parables and I just come to a summary of what all of these parables are getting at, this is my summary that I've come to. We get exaggerated statements in several of the parables, but they are promises of God's blessings. And so the obedient, those who spend the time with God, those blessings will come much greater than what you've put into it. But the next one, the next summary that I've come to is who is in and who is not. Okay? It is very distinct. It is very specific. Who is in? Who is in? So this is like the kingdom of heaven. Who is in the kingdom of heaven and who is not in the kingdom of heaven? It's very clear what this is. Okay? And we can see this as sort of a warning. Sort of a warning, right? Okay, so this is, I started reading this earlier, but from verse 51. Okay, do you understand all of these things? Yes, they said, we do. Then he added, every teacher of religious law who becomes a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like a homeowner who brings from his storeroom new gems of truth as well as old. Okay, so if you remember that I mentioned about this weird statement that says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Okay, this is an odd statement that is found throughout the Gospels, and it means, it's the same meaning as doing, okay? So if you are hearing, that means you are doing, and if you are not doing, you're not hearing, okay? So Jesus says, do you understand? And the disciple says, yes, okay, so since you do understand, then do it. Jesus is telling them to do it. If you're not doing it, then you don't understand. You don't really understand it, okay? So there's this treasure that's hidden, but Jesus is telling in this verse that the homeowner will bring the gems out. So these our treasure that who is hidden doesn't stay hidden. It comes out. It comes out. We come out. We're not meant to stay hidden from the world. We're meant to come out. Okay, and to show the people how to become a gem, I guess, or how to become a treasure. But then there's this last statement, gems of truth as well as new gems of truth as well as old, okay? So both gems are true. This is referring to the old laws of the Torah. But then Jesus was teaching us kind of a new law. He was confirming the old law, but he's also teaching us the new law. This is what this means, okay? New gems of truth as well as the old. So they both come out. But we must be the tree that bears good fruit. You want to be included in that treasure, you got to be the tree that bears good fruit. And this is confirmed in the parables that were shared, that was organized by Matthew. This is getting toward the end of Matthew chapter 13. And we've got this. I'll read this as well. When Jesus had finished telling these stories and illustrations, he left that part of the country. He returned to Nazareth, his hometown. When he taught there in the synagogue, everyone was amazed and said, "Where does he get this wisdom and the power to do miracles?" Then they scoffed. "He's just the carpenter's son, and we know Mary, his mother, and his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. All the sisters live right here among us. Where did he learn all these things?" And they were deeply offended and refused to believe in him. Then Jesus told them, "A prophet is honored everywhere except in his own hometown and among his own family. So he only did a few miracles there because of their unbelief." Okay. American Express has this phrase or saying, right? Membership has its benefits. Okay. The people of Nazareth rejected Jesus. They rejected Jesus, right? Jesus is from Nazareth. He was called a Nazarene. They rejected Jesus. But membership by association is not a ticket to heaven. And just because they grew up in the city doesn't mean they get to go to heaven. They just rejected Jesus, okay? But some people, if you ask, if you just go out in the world and you start asking, "Do you think you'll go to heaven?" And some of the answers you'll get are like, "Well, I was baptized." They don't go to church. They'll just say, "As a baby, I was baptized. So, yeah, I think I'll go to heaven." The other answer is, "Well, I used to go to church." Another answer might even be, "Well, I go to church." But that doesn't mean they will go to heaven. There's got to be other signs and not necessarily to our eyes. I mean, God will know in the end, but you know, there's got to be some evidence of your life that you are doing the things that God wants you to do. I have membership at the YMCA. Lindsay might be too young to know what the YMCA stands for, but me and Trevor, no problem, okay? So there was a time when the YMCA stood for Young Men's Christian Association. YWCA meant Young Women's Christian Association, okay? So I've got membership at this place, but that doesn't mean I'm a Christian. Even back then when they did recognize this name. They don't recognize this name anymore. It's become something else. But just because I have membership to this place, it doesn't mean I'm a Christian. So membership by association does not get you into heaven. There is something else that Jesus is telling us, and he's telling us through all of these parables. Okay, so to be called a child of God, it's not a formula, but a lifestyle. Okay, so Jesus uses parables to hide the truths from the kind of person who is not actively seeking God. They just don't want to spend the time. They just want to do whatever. Okay, so the ticket to heaven is not a formula. It is an active lifestyle of serving God. There's another passage in John that says if you are not bearing fruit, you're going to get cut off. That's kind of scary for me. Okay, so in your Christian life, if you are not bearing fruit, you're going to get cut off. The fruit you do bear should be good fruit. And so the other parable, we learned that sometimes you could bear bad fruit. Not so good. Okay? Jesus paid for the whole world with his life, but the treasure he is after are the ones who are bearing good fruit. It's very important. Love doesn't win. Not everyone gets a free ticket to heaven. And Jesus doesn't want a person to have a false sense of salvation. Now, we've got this thing that we like to tell people, especially when we're sharing the gospel, that salvation is a free gift. Salvation is a free gift, but then we tell people, but then you have to live in obedience to God. And it's like, wait a minute. You just told me salvation is a free gift, but then you're telling me I have to live a certain way. That means salvation is not a free gift. What does it mean when salvation is a free gift? Salvation is a free gift because there's no time frame that you have to have in order to perfect your life. There's no time frame. So if you receive Jesus Christ in your heart and you devote your life to Jesus and then you die a few hours later, just like that guy on the cross, one of the two guys that hung with Jesus, okay, That's the free gift. You get to go. But if you're not going to die, right, the same day, then the expectation is that Jesus wants you to live in obedience to God. Okay. So then you could say, well, okay, in that case, then on my deathbed, I'll commit my life to Christ. And you can say that, and that's not a bad thing. It's just that no one knows when you're going to go. No one knows that you're actually going to reach a senior age and you will slowly decline. No one knows that. No one knows that your heart will one day just stop. There is no deathbed to make this decision. If you've heard if you have heard the truth of Christ, then this truth was revealed to you by the Holy Spirit. It was spoken to you by me and you, but the actual truth was revealed to you by the Holy Spirit. And if you deny that truth, well, that's blaspheming the Holy Spirit, and that's unforgivable. Okay? It's unforgivable. And so you don't want to say, well, I'll just commit my life to Christ on my deathbed, because we have no idea when that's going to be. And if you do commit your life to Christ and it turns out that you're going to live another 50 years, well, God's going to expect you to live in obedience. But you see, living in that obedience to God doesn't mean that your freedom is reduced. It actually means that your freedom increases and your life becomes more full of joy. There's more joy in your life when we live in obedience to God. It's really exciting. There's a quote by William Barclay. He said, "It should be possible to identify the Christian in the school, the shop, the factory, the office, the hospital ward, everywhere. And the difference is this, that the Christian lives and works and behaves not as any human laws compel him to do so, but as the law of Christ compels him to do." Okay, so we're driven, motivated by the laws of Christ to do the things that we do. But it should be obvious that we are Christians by the way that we live. Okay. Matthew, going back to verse 50. So who is included? What is the membership? What are the requirements of the membership? Who is included in the kingdom of heaven? Who is considered to be a family of God? Who is considered to be the brother, sister, and mother of Jesus? Anyone who does the will of the Father in heaven, what is God's will? And that's one of the biggest and most important questions of young people today. What is God's will? What is God's specific will for your life? I don't know. What is God's general will for your life? It's this. And this is from Acts chapter 2. Okay. God is expecting everyone to be doing this, to worship. And this is not an exhaustive list. This is just, I would call this the basic foundation of a Christian, is to worship, to praise, to meditate on God's word. So meditating on God's word is an act of worship, right? Memorizing God's word, it's also an act of worship to God. Fellowship, it's coming together. Corporate worship, which is in the church, and small group meetings, that's fellowship. And then, of course, eating. And, you know, I don't think I want to go too many places if there wasn't food, but that's just me, okay? Prayer, right? Jesus wants you to pray, wants you to pray for others, intercession, okay? Giving and tithes, this is an expectation, okay? There's no amount, there's no minimum amount, but, you know, Old Testament does sort of model a minimum, which is, the word tithe actually means 10%, the word itself, it means 10%, but then in the New Testament, Jesus says, no, I want you to give everything, give it all. And then evangelism and missions. These are foundational. I would say it's the bare minimum. The church is the treasure of God. The church is the treasure of God, but not everyone in the church is bearing good fruit. That's not for me to judge, and I could be deceived. Like, it's really not hard to fool people into thinking that you're a good Christian. It's not hard at all. But God knows, okay? And so we want to be living in obedience, but by living in obedience to God, we gain more freedom, and we gain greater joy in our lives. And at the end of the world, people will be sifted and sorted. Okay, the real children of God will be separated from the pretenders or just people who are completely against God. Just spend a few moments in meditation as we're listening to this song. And then I'll close in prayer.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son and make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulder. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished.
Salvation is truly a free gift, but it was bought at a price, and Jesus paid a big price for it. For God so loved the world, and Jesus bought the whole world. He bought forgiveness for the entire world. But the treasure, it's not the world that he wants. He wants the treasure that was hidden away, and we want to be included in that treasure. We want to be pearls. We want to be identified as pearls. We want to be the choice pearls. And those who are the choice pearls are those who study God's word, who meditate God's word, who lives in obedience, who shares a message of love and embraces people, cares for the poor, the orphans and the widows. Is not one who is hidden away and does nothing, but is one who is active. And so we ask, Father God, Lord Jesus, forgive us, Father, if we've hidden ourselves away and just chosen to do nothing, expecting salvation. We do thank you, Lord, for this free gift. We thank you, Father, for Jesus, who's given his life, Lord, who suffered a terrible, terrible suffering. But through this, Father, because of your love, because of his love, he bought my salvation. He bought everyone's salvation. And because I love you, Lord, I want to obey you. I prove my love by obeying you. I pray, Father, that I know that in certain situations, maybe peer pressure. I know in junior high, high school, sometimes it's difficult to show our faith outwardly. Sometimes there's shame, bullying. It can be very difficult to bear. But Lord, you are stronger than that. You are above all of that, and you give us the strength. And so I pray, Father, for the strength of everyone here and beyond, Lord God, that we just can continue to stand up for who you are, Father, and continue to be faithful to the things that you've called us to do. I pray, Father, that that you help us, Father, to be faithful to the small things, to the tiniest things, Lord God, and let that be a stepping stone into the bigger things and maybe more challenging, more difficult things. But Father, I thank you, Lord, that you are patient. I thank you, Father, that you are slow to anger, and that you just want to watch us grow. And we just pray, Father, for that strength again, of boldness and just of a desire to be obedient to your will in all circumstances, whether we are at work, at school, at a concert, at a grocery store or whatever. Father, may we just have that measure of grace for one another, and just a desire, Father, to be a blessing to others. We need your strength to do that, Lord. We can't do it by our own strength because I mean, there's just some people I just don't like or can't tolerate. But Father, I really need your presence and your strength just to continue to pour love on people even I think may not deserve it. But everyone deserves your love. Everyone deserves the gift that you give. And help me, Lord, not to be prejudiced or to be selfish, but just to be a blessing. Because, Lord, you have blessed me way beyond measure. And let me share some of that with others. Give us the strength, Lord, to do this. Give us the boldness, Father. And let us not be ashamed of our faith. And now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, and ratified an eternal covenant with his blood, may he equip you with all you need for doing his will. May he produce in you, through the power of Jesus Christ, every good thing that is pleasing to him. All glory to him forever and ever. Amen.